With this picture, there's track processing. And what I mean by track processing, it's where we're tracking a physical phenomenon, maybe we're measuring strain or pressure, vibration. In this case, it would be pressure. And we can track it or do our measurement versus time. This is actually kind of a pass-by measurement. Or we could track it based on some RPM step, right? We're doing a sweep. We're sweeping some component or engine through an RPM. And there are two important things that we need to think about if we're doing some type of track processing. The frame size and this idea of increment. But let's talk about that for a second. So when we talk about increment, we're talking about if this track processing that we're doing, we're talking about the time step, how long there is in between measurements, points, or calculations. So for example, if we have an increment of 1 second, then we're going to be taking data or making calculations starting here, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, or if we had an increment of 2 seconds, right, we can set it based on our preference. It could even be smaller, 0.25 seconds, for example. So we have a very fine time step. We're taking lots of measurements slash calculations. Now, with frame size, it's just the amount of data that we need to do an FFT calculation. So if we're starting with our increment here at this point zero, and we have a frame size of 1 second, then it would look like this. We need all of that data. Or if we had 2 seconds, it would be a larger frame size. It could be smaller, right? This is user selectable, our frame size. And that's all going to depend on, as we say, what our frequency resolution is. Now, hopefully in that example, you started to think that, or get the point that your frame size and your increment don't have to necessarily be the same. They don't have to be equal. So for example, in this case, when the frame size is smaller than the increment, and now hopefully you read the color coding, the blue is our frame, and these points are our increments, right? These are the points where we're taking data. So if we look at this example, because our frame size is smaller than that increment, what happens to this data? It's going to be missed or skipped, we should say. It's not going to be processed.
And you're just full of all sorts of ways to lower the results, huh, Charles?
Yeah, exactly. Because you might say, well, that's not a big problem. But what if the scenario is that you do have some important information, some large amplitudes happening in the sections that are skipped because our frame size is not the same as our increment? As Pete said, now it becomes important because we don't really want to lower the amplitude like that. We would probably rather lower it with the countermeasure. But
yeah, so if it was a constant amplitude sine wave throughout, we could skip part of it. It probably wouldn't matter average wise, huh? But something like this, it definitely would, huh?
Yeah, and I think we're going to have an example. I'll show you the end today to kind of show you the importance of being careful here. In this case, with these higher amplitudes, you say, well, I gotta have that in my measurement. So a good solution, we might think, well, what if I just make my frame size equal to my increment? All right, great. We've captured it. No problem, right? Well, looking at this data, remember what we talked about the Fourier transform, and we need to have periodic data. If we look at this, it looks random, right? Non-periodic. We need a window. So just increasing the frame size to be equal to the increment won't mean that we capture this important information here. Because remember, when we apply a window, what happens? We have this non-periodic signal. We apply the window and we affect the ends of the data. So when we go back to our signal here and look at it again, yes, our frame size are equal. We're capturing the data. But when we apply the window here, that Hanning window, for example, remember this is zero here? We're going to affect the amplitudes at the ends of our signal still. So what can we do to avoid that? Well, we could make our frame size larger than the increment and create overlap. So let's say now our frame size is not equal to the increment. It was actually even larger, but these are still the points where we're going to be taking data. So there's actually going to be some overlap. So let's just do three averages and then take a look at it. So for example, if we look at this second average here, this portion in the first average that was affected by the window will now be actually included in the second average. And where it was zero before, we can see it's not the case. That amplitude, whatever's happening there in that portion of time, will not be attenuated to the degree it is in the first average. So we'll be included in our average and we'll be able to get a more accurate result. That's kind of an example of when we're talking about tracked on time, but the same ideas matter if we talk about tracked on RPM. We still have an increment and a frame size, but now the increment is related to an RPM step, not a time step. And these are something that we can select, whatever RPM time step we want in our sweep or frame size. But something that we cannot change is set by just the data or the test itself, and that's the sweep rate. So we're talking about, you're doing this tracked measurement where you're tracking on RPM, the sweep rate, we're talking about the amount of RPM change per second, like how fast you're sweeping up through your RPM range that you're measuring. That's not a parameter we can set. That's going to be dictated by the test, but it still becomes very important with this idea of frame size and RPM increment now, not time step, but RPM increment. So for this example, imagine that we have a slow change in RPM signal. So our step, as you can see, we're taking steps of 100 RPM. So 1,000, 1,100, 1,200. Now, our frame size is set such that it's actually a smaller amount of time than it takes to get to our next RPM step. So what does that mean? Well, again, we're in this scenario where we're going to be missing data, skipping data, because our sweep rate is so slow. This takes a larger amount of time to get that increase to 1,100 RPM versus our frame size. But if we had a rapidly changing RPM, you can see this slope is a lot smaller. This is steeper slope, so our sweep rate's higher. We still have the same RPM step, right, of 100 RPM. And these are our measurement points, our RPM increments. But now we're actually going to have overlap because we're actually getting to that next RPM step at a shorter period than our frame size. So now we have overlap, and as we already saw, that's a good situation for us. This is also an important point that we could actually have a test scenario where if our RPM sweep rate isn't consistent, some portions of it we have overlap, other portions we were increasing much slower to get to the next RPM step, that we missed data. So it's something to definitely think about. I mean, maybe you would process a certain portion of it differently and then the other half based on this type of sweep rate, but it's something we want to keep in mind so that we're not missing important information in our testing. And let me go do a quick test lab demo. So I have my test lab open and we have some time data. Show it to you real quick, somewhere around here. So this is our time history that we're going to just do some process. And I just opened the desktop, advanced desktop module in test lab, and we're just using the add-in signature throughput time data processing. So what we're going to do is just let's save our data in this demo folder so we don't confuse it. Let's grab one of our time histories, put it in an input basket. We can see our time history. We'll go over to time data processing. We'll select that. And we'll go to acquisition parameters. And this is where we're going to set the information with regard to how we're tracking it. This one we're going to track on time. This time history is 25 seconds. And we're going to do several increments. We'll start off with 1 second is our increment. And we will keep our frame size constant at 0.25.
So okay. We got some gaps here in that case.
Yeah, exactly. So make sure the name's good. We'll calculate that. We'll go back and now we will make our gap a little smaller. We'll go half a second. Calculate that. And one more. Let's make it the same increment and frame size. And what we say what happened, we would not have any gaps in our data. Calculate that as well.
We're gap-free.
Gap-free.
All right.
Let's take a look at our data. We'll just do list all blocks. And we calculated some overall levels. I had that turned on. We'll just look at the overall level versus time, all three of these different increments. So the red is our 1 second increment, and we have a frame size of 0.25. So we have a lot of gap. And we see automatically, pretty quickly, what are the effects. We're missing a lot of the peak information. It's not captured for us with this 1 second because we have such a large gap between our frame size and our increment. Now, if we jump down
to- Yeah, I thought
to,
with gaps, you would miss the peak, but you also miss the valleys too, huh?
Yeah, that's an interesting point too, yeah.
Wow.
And we see when we had it the equal frame size and as well as increment, we are capturing the peaks and the valleys appropriately. The one in the middle, for the most part, it's missing as well some of the important peaks when we have a half second instead of 0.25 increment. So hopefully this highlights the point to you that it's important when we're talking about these track processing, especially to understand the difference between our frame size and our increment. And I think I will switch back over to-
You're zoomed in here, right? Can we just see like sure. You did 25 seconds or something? Just curious. Yeah. So quite a difference throughout. Didn't matter.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Thanks, Charles.
No problem.